Today we will have a discussion on tongue thrusting habit. So first of all, there are lots of definitions given for tongue thrusting habit, others like Prophet, Tully, etc. So basically, tongue thrusting is defined as a condition in which the tongue makes contact with any teeth anterior to the molar during swallowing. Prophet defined tongue thrust swallowing as placement of the tongue tip forward between incisors during swallowing, whereas Tully in 1969 defined tongue thrust as the forward movement of the tongue tip between the teeth to meet the lower lip during the deglutition and in sounds of speech so that the tongue lies interdentition. So learn at least one of these definitions while you are writing or if you are asked to explain regarding tongue thrusting habit. So first thing which you should write is the definition, either which is given by Prophet or Tully. So basically, tongue thrusting is nothing but tongue makes in contact with any teeth anterior to the molar during the swallowing process. So one of the classification of tongue thrusting habit is by given like this: physiologic, habitual, functional, and anatomic. Physiological is this comprise of the normal tongue thrust swallowing of the infancy. So that will gradually change as the tooth erupts, anterior teeth erupts, and the once the child have a proper solid food. Whereas habitual is tongue thrust swallow is present as a habit even after correction of the malocclusion. So even once this malocclusion is corrected, still the tongue thrust persists. So that type, we call it as a habitual type of tongue thrust. Whereas functional is an adaptive behavior developed to active oral seal. So in order to attain an act oral seal, they will functionally adapt the tongue position to get a proper oral seal. That's why we call it as it's a functional type of a tongue thrust. Whereas anatomic is due to some kind of anatomical defects or changes. For example, enlarged tongue can have an anterior tongue posture. So in case of macroglossia and all, this because of this anatomy, the child will gradually have a tongue thrust. Another classification is given by Breuer and Holt. He classified into four types. Type 1 is non-deformity tongue thrust, deforming anterior tongue thrust, whereas the subgroup 1 includes anterior open bite. Type 2 includes two subgroups, subgroup 2 and subgroup 3. Subgroup 2 is associated with procumbency of anterior teeth, and subgroup 3 is associated posterior cross bite, whereas type 3 is deformity lateral tongue thrust. So here type 3 includes lateral tongue thrust. So whatever subgroups which include there in are basically the signs which you see in a lateral tongue thrust habit. Subgroup 1 is posterior open bite, subgroup 2 is posterior cross bite, subgroup 3 is deep bite. In type 4, it is deformity associated and lateral tongue thrust. So here subgroup 1 is anterior and posterior open bite. It is basically a combined anterior and lateral tongue thrust together. So subgroup 1 is anterior and posterior open bite. Subgroup 2 is associated with procumbency of the anterior teeth. And subgroup 3 is associated posterior cross bite. So this is the Breuer and Hall's classification for tongue thrust. And there is one more classification which says simple tongue thrust and complex tongue thrust. So we'll move on to the etiology. There are so many etiological factors which might lead to tongue thrust habit, like retained infantile swallow, upper respiratory tract infections, neurological disturbances, some of the feeding practices which the child come across during their infancy and childhood, induced due to other, like it might be connected or related to other oral habits, then it can be genetic or hereditary, anatomical considerations like tongue size. So this etiology was basically proposed by Fletcher. So Fletcher has proposed the following factors as being the cause for tongue thrusting. So he came up with an idea like etiology, certain etiologies under some headings. So if you learn this pattern, it will be very easy for you to understand, and you can explain it under these headings. So first you have to explain about the genetic or hereditary factor. So they are specific anatomic or neuromuscular variation in the orofacial region that can precipitate tongue thrust. Example, hypotonic orbicularis oris activity. So this can genetically or hereditarily pass on to the upcoming generation. And if you take a proper history and see if the parents or see for the parental history, if they are having the similar pattern of swallowing and external features, they are check for their tongue size, tongue variations, this how is their orbicularis oris activity. So if you look on to that, you can relate the history from the child to the parents or any grandparents or any relatives. Learned behavior is nothing but it's a habitual type. Tongue thrust can be acquired as a habit. Following are some of the predisposing factors are improper bottle feeding can lead to tongue thrust. Prolonged thumb sucking is found to have a good role in developing tongue thrust. Prolonged tonsillar and upper respiratory tract infection. Then prolonged duration of tenderness of gum or teeth can result in change in swallowing pattern to avoid onto the tender zone. So this point shows that basically tongue is adapting a new position in order to avoid the tender areas inside the oral cavity. Whereas when they spoke about the upper respiratory tract infection, examples are mouth breathing habit, if the child has a chronic tonsillitis, allergies, they have there is a tendency for this tongue to push forward due to some kind of pain and decrease in the amount of space which brings about tongue thrust swallow. This may also present due to the physiological need to maintain an adequate airway. So if there is no proper adequate airway, tongue will gradually position itself to provide an adequate airway. That is why we relate it with the upper respiratory tract infections. Feeding practices include prolonged feeding and improper swallowing pattern has been attributed as one of the etiological factors for tongue thrusting. Some of the maturational factors are, one of the maturational factors is retained infant swallow. Normally, once the child starts having solid food and if the anterior, decidus anterior teeth erupts, gradually this infantile swallow will get transformed to the normal swallow pattern. But if it does not happen, if there is any maturational factor, there is an hindrance in this maturational change, then tongue thrusting will be present. Functional adaptability means tongue can protrude when the incisors are missing. So if there is a long-term missing of anterior teeth, then gradually the tongue will position for the functional adaptability and will lead to tongue thrusting habit. And some of the mechanical restrictions are the macroglossus, size of the tongue. Neurological disturbances like hypersensitive palate, moderate motor disability, disruption of sensory control and coordination swallowing can lead to tongue thrust. So coming to the clinical features, there are extraoral features and intraoral features. In extraoral features, you have to look into the lip posture where lip separation is more both at rest and in function. The mandibular movement, like part of the mandible movement is upward and backward with tongue movement forward. And when you look into the speech, lip sync problems like articulation of S, N, T, D, L, the, Z, V sounds, like there will be some kind of, if you listen to their pronunciation, there will be a little articulation problem for them. Facial form, there will be increased anterior facial height. Intraorally, if you look into their tongue posture, tongue tip at rest is lower because of the anterior open bite. And when you look into the movement of the tongue while swallowing, movement is irregular from one swallow to another. And some of the malocclusion which is present, if you look into the maxilla and mandibular, in maxilla, there will be obvious proclination of the maxillary anteriors, an increased overjet, maxillary constriction will be present, generalized spacing between the teeth, and in mandible, you can see retroclination of the mandible. So this is one of the chart which is present in one of your textbook. Like simple tongue thrust, what are the features? Like normal tooth contact in posterior region will be there, but in simple tongue thrust, anterior open bite will be present. And contraction of the lips, mentalis muscle and mandibular elevators will be seen once if you ask the patient to swallow. So while swallowing, you can see the contraction of the lips, mentalis muscle and mandibular is elevated. In case of complex tongue thrusting, there will be generalized open bite. The absence of contraction of lip and oral musculature will be seen while swallowing. Whereas in lateral tongue thrust, posterior open bite with lateral tongue thrust will be present. So other features are proclination of the anterior tooth, anterior open bite will be there, midline diastema, posterior cross bite. So coming to the diagnosis, history is very important. So while taking the history, determine the swallow pattern of the siblings and parent to check for hereditary or any genetic variations, genetical hereditary transfer of these factors are there. See if you can relate to that. Information regarding upper respiratory tract infection is important. Any previous sucking habits are there. Finally, past and present information regarding the overall abilities. So in order to get a psychological approach to the child to motivate and reinforce to unlearn this habit, we need to understand the overall abilities, interest and motivation of the patient. So on extraoral examination, the facial profile is examined. So how do you examine such patients? How do you identify? So these are the methods. On extraoral examination, facial profile is examined to confirm the favorable and unfavorable growth pattern. For example, steepness of the mandibular plane angle and anterior facial height is an evident example if you look into the facial profile. On method of examination of the tongue, check for the size of the tongue, shape, how does it move, see the movement of the tongue, and functional examination, observe the tongue position while the mandible is in the rest position, and observe the tongue during various swallow, like conscious swallow and command swallow. And all of these are actually examined when the patient is seated upright. And you can even ask the patient to have a little of water. A little water is placed in the patient mouth, and then you have to make the patient, ask the patient to swallow it. So then you will be able to assess the swallowing pattern. So how is this normal swallowing and the abnormal swallowing differ? So in a normal swallow pattern, the lip touches each other tightly and mandible rise as tight teeth are brought together and facial muscle do not show any marked contraction. So if you see, look into the patient swallowing, there won't be much effort happening on the face or the muscles of facial expressions. Whereas in an abnormal swallow, the teeth will be apart, lip do not touch each other, facial muscles show marked contraction. And the lower lip is lightly held with thumb and finger and patient is asked to swallow the water. So if you make the patient just retract the lip and see the swallowing pattern, you can see that the tongue will come forward to the incisor region. So this is how basically a mature adult swallow. The tongue touches the anterior palate. The lip contacts tightly, forming lip seal, creating negative pressure inside the oral cavity, and the mandible is stabilized by muscles of mastication. Whereas in infantile swallow, what happens is there is no lip seal. So in order to attain that lip seal, the tongue will come forward. The tongue protrudes in between the gum pads and contact the lip. The lips are apart. The mandible is balanced by muscles of facial expression. So in an infantile swallow case, the muscles are it is basically balanced by muscles of facial expression. And this type of swallow matures once the teeth erupts and comes in contact with the when the child starts taking solid food. So under palpatory examination, one of the palpatory examination is checking the temporalis muscle activity. So place hand over the temporalis muscle and ask to swallow. In a normal condition, this temporalis will contract in the mandible when the mandible is elevated. In a tongue thrust habit, when you ask the patient to swallow, there won't be temporalis contraction. So this is in like brief about the functional examination of how you assess or how do you identify a tongue thrust in a patient. So these are the points which you should note. Observe the tongue position while the mandible is in the rest position. Observe the tongue during various swallow. Various swallow is what you have to check for: the conscious swallow, command swallow of the saliva, command swallow of the water, conscious swallowing during mastication. So these are the various swallows which you have to check on to a patient. Then coming to palpatory examination, place water beneath the patient's tongue tip and ask him to swallow. So in a normal condition, mandible rises and teeth are brought together, but no contraction of the lip or facial muscles are seen. Whereas in a tongue thrusting, marked contraction of the lips and facial muscles are seen. Place hand over, another technique is placing hand over temporalis muscle and ask to swallow. In a normal pattern, temporalis contracts and mandible is elevated, whereas in tongue thrust, no temporalis contraction is found. Next is hold the lower lip and ask the patient to swallow. So in a normal swallow can be completed. In tongue thrusting habit, patient will suffer. Like you can see the patient pulling the lip towards and you can see definite, the facial muscles will contract. Next is your management. So how do you manage such patients with tongue thrusting habits? So here the patient is instructed to put the tip of the tongue. There are so many various exercises to train the tongue to come into a normal position. So here, this is one of the exercises. They are instructed to put the tip of the tongue at the correct position and swallow with the lip first and teeth in occlusion. So training to correct swallow and posture of the tongue is very important in a tongue thrusting habit patient. Another important exercise is a flat sugarless throat drop. It can be placed in the back of the tongue and it is held against the palate in correct position until it is completely dissolved twice a day. So this is actually a sugar candy exercise. When patient learn normal tongue position, this has to be reinforced and made into an unconscious act. So basically daily practicing such habits can train the position of the tongue. So when the patient learn normal tongue position, this has to be reinforced and made into an unconscious act. This is very important. Reinforcement and motivation of the patient is very important in management of the tongue thrusting habit. If it doesn't work, then you have to move on with the appliance therapy. It is initiated for a child basically above the age of 9. Appliances used can either be fixed and fixed with band, palatal rake or removable. There are various habit breaking appliances. It can be either fixed or removable appliances, and based on the patient compliance we will see what type of appliance which we can give. For example, non-palatal arch, removable appliances are there, fixed habit breaking appliances are there, bluegrass appliances are there, so many other appliances are there. This is one of the fixed rake appliances which has got an acrylic embedded to there, and this is your non-palatal arch appliance. This will also help to position the tongue in. Give them exercises to train the tongue to a normal position. And other things are you can give them exercises using orthodontic elastics, lemon candy exercises. This is the same as that of the sugarless drop exercises, which you can ask the patient to keep the candy onto the palatal area, then squeeze it, salivate, and ask them to swallow. Porous exercise is nothing but it's the same as that of the lemon candy exercises. Give them a spot, ask them to place a candy or a sugar drop there, then spot the four S's are spot, salivating, squeezing and swallow. So these are the four S's. So spot, give a appropriate spot for the proper positioning of the tongue, then you have to squeeze that place, salivate and swallow. That is how they will learn how to properly position the tongue. Then there are lip exercises like tug of war and button pull exercises. Button pull exercises is nothing but one end, there are like in two ends of a band, we will keep a button. So one button will go inside the oral cavity and the other will be outside. Then we should pull the button like outside, and what you're supposed to do is the button which is kept inside with the lip, we have to purse it inside and do not allow this button to pop out. So like that, lip exercises will happen. Subconscious therapy, like we have to give affirmations, like make the patient repeat this 6 times, like I will swallow correctly all night long. So 10 nights, if you repeat, ask them to sit in front of the mirror and ask them to like tell this to themselves, that I will swallow correctly all night long. This is kind of a positive affirmation which might help to reinforce or motivate the patient to change the pattern of the swallow pattern or tongue thrusting habit. That's all with tongue thrusting habits. So you can get this question as a short essay or even a short note. So in that condition, you have to learn the definition, classification, the clinical features, major clinical features, then management part, what are the exercises, then learn what are the habit breaking appliances which is commonly used and its design. So thank you.